I have a little guy that's going to come up and see me about now. And maybe Mom and Dad will come up too. I'll bet they will. This is Anson Charles Scott. And we both forgot about this until late last night. She said, oh, by the way, are you going to dedicate this little one? You have brought Anson Charles Scott to be dedicated formally and publicly to God and to his service. By this act, you signify your faith in Christ and your desire that Anson will receive the benefits of consecration to God and to the prayerful support of the church, and may early learn to know and follow the will of God, serving him faithfully. In order that this may be accomplished, it will be your duty as parents to teach him early the fear of the Lord, to watch over his education, that he may not be led astray by false teachings or doctrines, to direct his mind to the Holy Scriptures, to direct his feet to the sanctuary, and to restrain him from evil associates and habits, and as much as possible, to bring Anson up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. And will you endeavor to do so by the help of the Lord? From Matthew 19, people were bringing little children to Jesus to have him touch them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant, and he said to them, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." And I tell you the truth, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. He took the children in his arms, he put his hands on them, and he blessed them. So this service of dedication is as much for the parents as it is for the children, or the little one. Raising and mentoring Anson is not the responsibility, as you know, of the government or the school or even the church. The responsibility is yours, Jeff and Shelby. Hopefully, the ministry of this church or your church, wherever you attend, will be of significant assistance. You're in a position to be of the greatest value to him, to teach him to pray and obey, to read the Word of God, when he gets old enough to read the Word of God, and to teach him integrity, honesty, humility, and above all, to help him to know Christ in a personal way when he reaches the age of proper understanding and the age of accountability. Do you, Jeff and Shelby, promise to pray for him? We might have to trade for a minute. Do you promise to pray for and with Anson for his growth in the knowledge of God?
Yes.
Do you promise to train him in body and mind and spirit for service to fellowship with God?
Yes.
Do you promise to do all you can to lead him at the proper time to a personal faith in Jesus?
Yes.
Let's pray. Father, we do here now dedicate Anson to you and to your service, praying that you would keep your hand of protection upon him. Grant to the parents and every person in this place grace and wisdom and strength. Amen. Anson, I'm going to get you wet. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And he didn't scream at me. That's a wonderful, wonderful thing. Okay. I get him back for a minute, okay? If you will stand, I commend to your love and to your offer your grace, I commend to you Anson Charles Scott. So I ask you, will you so live your lives that Anson and the children in your world will be surrounded by love, encouraged in their faith, and exposed to principles of eternal value? And if you will, you'll say, "We will." God bless you. You may be seated. And here's a Bible. He might suck on it, probably not quite ready to read it. And you take this with you as well. Okay, bye-bye. That's my number two great-grandson. I never lived, think I'd live long enough to see a great-grandson. I don't know how long I thought I would live, but who knows? Well, as you prepare for the holiday on Thursday, are you conscious of anything that stands in your mind that you're thankful for? And, you know, in other words, if I hadn't asked, are you just thankful for something? Hopefully we are. Gerda Weissman Klein, you may know the name, was among prisoners in a death camp. And she recalls standing for hours. She recalls standing in what was called roll call in this death camp and nearly collapsing from hunger and fatigue. And she was there among thousands of prisoners, women. And those women, almost without any exception, noticed one little crack with one little flower coming through that crack, a very beautiful little flower. And it was the only thing of beauty in that entire camp. Everything else was gray and ugly. And they took great pains to avoid ever stepping on that little flower. They stepped around it every time because it was maybe they were thankful for that one single flower, one single thing of beauty in that place. There's so many things that we should be thankful for that we're not. She would say later when asked, why did you go on? Someone asked her, why did you go on? Like she had a choice, of course, but how could you go on in that situation? And she said, the only picture that came to my mind was when I went to that first camp, I kept seeing this picture. And she said, it was a picture of my father smoking a pipe and my mother at her needlepoint and my brother and I were doing homework. And she says, just that, my goodness, it was just about as boring an evening as you can possibly imagine. And she said, that picture would be the driving force that would help me to survive and struggle for survival. We do have very much to be thankful for, and yet sometimes we're not very thankful, are we? I trust you are. Let's bow our heads, hearts together as we pray. Father, we humbly bow before you as we prepare to celebrate this special day. We bow our hearts in your presence. As we enter this Thanksgiving week, we do offer thanks for all of your gifts, your many gifts. I pray that you'd help us to not only be thankful, but Lord, to live in a spirit of gratitude and generosity to those of our community and our neighbors. Thank you, God, for providing the necessities as well as the luxuries of life that we enjoy so much more than almost anyone else in the world. Even if we're poor, we have so much more than most people in the world. Thank you for guiding us through difficult times. Thank you for giving us the courage to face whatever comes our way, whatever happens tomorrow. Most of all, we thank you for the unconditional love and the amazing grace that you offer and for being an ever-present source of comfort and hope that we so desperately sometimes need. Meet the special needs represented by the congregation today. You know what they are. I pray, Lord, that you would be with the special needs that I mentioned and probably many that I haven't mentioned that are on our prayer list and our hope chest. Give wisdom to our community leaders. Be with our nation and our leaders and be with those who live on the street and be with those who live in the woods and be with those who sometimes sleep on our doorstep. We don't know what's going on in their world. We don't know why they're there. We often try to help them. We pray, Lord, that you would minister your grace to them through your people in whatever way you would offer that grace. We just thank you, Lord, for your many blessings. Make us one as we serve you together. And so we offer this prayer this morning, O God, with a thankful heart. In your name we pray. Amen.
Probably one of the things that I am most grateful for is the Bible, God's word to us, his written word, where any time, any place, we can open it up and read what he has to say to us. And what a blessing it is. We'd like to sing for you, Thy Word.
To my feet and alive. be my guide and hold me to your side.
When I talk about the church, the family of God, the bride of Christ, I consciously endeavor to minimize our differences. Because quite frankly, the closer you look at churches, mainstream churches, there's not a lot of difference. I mean, we really like to argue about a few little things. I don't like to argue, and it doesn't usually happen in the pulpit, but it happens quite often in the Sunday school classes of churches everywhere. But I like to minimize our differences. But of course, there are some denominational distinctions. But what we've been talking about, what we believe about sanctification and perfection, really doesn't set us apart as much as one might believe. So the three words, again, that we've been talking about, and I'll try if I can bring this together next week, and you can say, oh, okay, for a few that haven't followed me real well. Maybe I'm not a good leader. That's what John Maxwell or somebody said, if nobody's following, you're not a leader. So, but holiness and entire sanctification and perfection were the three words. So let me ask you a question, maybe not a fair question to put you on the spot, but how many of you know something about sanctification? I mean, really? Not a lot of hands, right? So I don't even have to ask the next question. I was going to ask if you're on a talk show and there was for $10,000, define sanctification, would you take the money home? I'm going to try to have it in a form that you can actually look at next week. But let me make this point. Let's look at Global or United Methodist, either one. Here's just a little touch of what they believe, or we believe. We hold that the wonder of God's acceptance and pardon does not end God's saving work, which continues to nurture our growth in grace through the power of the Holy Spirit. We're enabled to increase in the knowledge and the love of God and in love for our neighbor. Okay, let's look at the Wesleyan Church, which I was in for several years. Very first sentence in paragraph, page, blah, blah, blah. The Wesleyan Church has grown out of a revival movement which has historically given itself to one mission, the spreading of scriptural holiness throughout every land. How about the Roman Catholic Church? The Catholic Church upholds the doctrine of sanctification, teaching that sanctifying grace is that grace which confers on our souls a new life that is sharing in the life of God. For the individual, it is a close union with God and the resulting moral perfection. Nazarene Church. Entire sanctification is that act of God subsequent to regeneration by which the believers are made free from original sin and depravity and brought into a state of entire devotion to God and the holy obedience of love made perfect. Southern Baptist, sanctification is a glorious is glorious and necessary, and it goes on to say, pursue holiness. Presbyterian, sanctification is the evidence of our justification. It is necessary if we're to live to the glory of God. It is a necessary aspect of our preparation to meet God, for without holiness, no man will meet the Lord. Ooh, I remember hearing that one a lot when I was a kid. They kind of threw that at you. Without holiness, no man will see the Lord. Reformed Baptist, similar. Episcopal Church, a little weaker, but still it's there. A Lutheran Church, to make Christ present so that humans can partake in the redemptive work. Not real strong, but it's there. It's there in the Church of Christ, the Pentecostal Church, the Christian Church. So, okay, Pastor, we get the message, maybe. Sanctification and holiness are words that represent the highest value in our walk with God and in most churches. And you never hear about it. We never talk about it. Well, the Methodist Church became the Methodist Church because they talked about it. But over the years, it's not always that easy to understand when we talk about justification and sanctification and glorification and so forth. So, but I think it's worth going where we're going. So, we all believe in a deeper walk. I'm not trying to dumb it down, but I'm trying to make you understand kind of where I am with this. We want to be mature in Christ. That's another word. That's a legal word for that. So, I believe, however, if you tell people, say, well, you need to be sanctified. Well, I believe the experience is unique to every believer. In fact, some people arrive at what you would call the sanctified life without ever knowing the mechanics, without ever knowing the theology, without ever knowing the correct terms. How do they do that? Because they're being faithful in their walk with God. And maybe I'll bring a little bit of that out today. If not, I will next week. Growing in Christ and seeking to please God every day. Now, if you come to church every Sunday and you never pick up a Bible and you never think about anything spiritual, then you're probably not entirely sanctified in the sense that I'm talking about. That doesn't mean you're not going to heaven. That just means that you're not seeking God for all that he wants to give you, do with you, and do through you. So, being purified, set apart in the process of the Christian walk, that's sanctified. Okay, so I started out talking about sanctification, but then you might say, well, you use the word holiness. So what's that about? Well, sanctification and holiness translates the same. Sanctification describes the process to holiness. Sanctification translates from the Latin sanctus or holy or holiness, or in Hebrew kadosh. It is the work of the Holy Spirit that sets us apart and enables us to love and to be obedient to the max, to be obedient the best we can be. And from that moment, there's a growth process that will bring us to the crisis experience, which some of you may know right where that is, and others will maybe just go right through there, and you'll grow in Christ, and you'll go to heaven, and you say, I never did figure out that sanctification thing, but, and God may say, well, you had it whether you knew it or not because of how you've grown in Christ and how you've come to a point where you look out there and you say, or you look in here and you say, oh, I love you, Lord, but I just don't feel like I've arrived. There must be something more. And that's kind of what people like, you know, the people that we think of as great, the old scholars and, well, some that we'll talk about today just for a moment, Wesley, people like that that made a huge difference. But they spent years just trying to understand the word. And actually, they've understood it for us. That helps us. We don't have to go back and try to figure some things out if we want to open our hearts to that. So, the term crisis defined when believers become aware of their need for Christ's provision and appropriate it by faith to his work. It's like, God, I just need more of you. And we'll talk about that a little bit more. I'm just trying to get there. Next Sunday, probably the last Sunday, I'll talk about this. But okay, most denominations and parachurch, I've already said this in one way, but let me say in another. Most denominations, parachurch groups, teach a crisis experience, but they use different nomenclatures and different terms. So this is what you hear if you go to one church and then to another. We need a closer union with God. Or you need to be fully consecrated. That would definitely be Baptist. You need to be filled with the Spirit. You need to have a crisis experience. You need to be sanctified. And some say you have to include speaking in tongues. Okay? Thank you, Lord, that I have tasted of the good things of God now. And how? Okay, Hebrews 6:1. Let us leave the elementary teachings about Christ and go on to maturity from the book of Hebrews. Hebrews 6:1. So if you listen closer to me in the next 5 minutes or so, you might pick up a little John Oswald, who's a great scholar. I'm not. I know I met John. I took his, got a picture with him, Dennis Kinlaw. He's passed away. Or Marlon Hodel. I've had him come to speak at my church. All these guys are scholars. I've learned more from these guys than I have in seminary. They all are teachers in seminary, too, though, but I had an opportunity, more of a one-on-one. So let's think about some significant facts and distinctions and expressions. Important truths, facts. Number one, now, I don't know, don't even ask me why I've got the outline this way, but if you see the outline and you're filling it in, just write truth, principle. I don't know why that's there, but you'll understand. Sanctification is critical to spiritual growth. We are all called to be holy. In other words, if you believe there are a few super Christians and the rest of us are just forgiven, but we got no influence, then you're reading a different book than I'm reading. We all have influence. All have spheres of influence. Sometimes we act as if the Bible is limited to just the New Testament. And a lot of people just want to stay in the New Testament. I have a habit, whether it's good or bad, of enjoying preaching out of the Old Testament. And you've experienced that, I know. But sometimes we act that way. If you read only the New Testament, you might get the idea that salvation is simply to be saved from guilt and condemnation of sin, and that is all. But if you read the Old Testament and the New Testament together carefully, you see that salvation is much more. We're children of the Reformation. Maybe we think the Christian faith started there. It didn't. Perhaps we think it started in the first century. But if you look through the pages of the Old Testament, you discover this incredible hunger and thirst for righteousness and holiness and godliness in the Old Testament. You read the heart of David over and over and over. When you read the psalm, he says, "Oh God, you are my God. I shall seek you earnestly. My soul thirsts for you, for I wait all the day." So salvation is not only to be freed from the guilt and the condemnation of sin, but also from the power of sin. Why did Jesus come and cleanse the temple? I mean, you remember, he knocked over the tables and he pushed the money changers out. They were selling and they were cheating people. He did that so he could take up residence there. Why sanctification? Then the same question. So that God the Holy Spirit can come in fullness of in our lives and take up residence. But first of all, he wants to cleanse the temple. He's cleansing the temple. I am the temple. Sanctification is not, I said this before, sanctification is not just about what we avoid, it's also about what we produce, the difference that we make, the fruit that the Bible talks about. So that's number one. Number two, sanctification comes by faith. John Wesley in the early days was a good example, and some of you heard me say this because I shared it at the Bible study, and I think I shared it on a Sunday morning, but I'll do it quickly. Kind of a good example of this. Through the years, Christians have sought to be holy and perfect and mature, but all too often we've tried to be holy in our own strength. We can never do that. John Wesley was on board a ship bound for Savannah, St. Simon's Island, Fort Frederica, right there off the coast of Brunswick. If you've never been there and you go by, it's a great place to go, not just because there's a lot of history at Fort Frederica. That was there, of course, to defend against the Spanish. And John went there and his brother for 2 years. And found out they weren't much. they left thinking not too highly of themselves. But at any rate, they went there to be chaplains. And one of them was in Savannah and one at St. Simon's. So on the ship, they met this Moravians who were kind of humble, Christ-like. I think John felt like they were sort of superior to them, maybe more spiritually knowledgeable. But sometime while they were there, if you remember, a storm came onto the ship. It actually broke the mainsail, and the ship floundered. And all the the English people were just terrified, including him and Charles and all their friends. But the Moravians, they sang and played those little mandolins or whatever you play. And they were good. So finally afterwards, he asked, weren't you afraid? And one of the gentlemen said, no. In fact, he said, I thank God, no. And so he said, well, what about the women and children? Weren't they fearful? No. We trust God. We're not afraid to die. So following that, for the next 2 years in Georgia, Wesley's worried by the thought that he didn't have a real faith in God that he wanted. Why was he so frightened when these Christians weren't? Now, remember the question, can I trust God? And we glibly say, yes, I trust God. Oh, yes, I do. Well, there will be experiences sooner or later in your life that will confirm whether you really trust God or not, when the rubber meets the road, as my friend used to say. In the evening of Wednesday, May the 24th, 1738, Wesley went unwillingly, you remember, some of you remember me saying, to a society in Aldersgate. Now, they're back from Georgia, and they are nursing their wounds and feeling like, well, we went over there to be chaplains, and they didn't feel like they accomplished anything. So, you remember this. He'd gone to Aldersgate to a society. I can't tell you all the different groups, but they started not with a church, but they started with different levels of groups. And one was a society, a group of people, kind of like a Bible study group. And he went there that night. He didn't want to go. I don't know what it is, but that was the night, a quarter before nine, while he was describing the change which God works in the heart through faith. And this was, they were actually reading, they were actually, someone was reading the preface to the book of Romans that night. So about a quarter to nine, he said, I felt, and these were famous words, I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in God. And sometimes that's all it takes, is that I don't have the faith, and then all of a sudden it grips you, and you just know it. You don't ever have to know it. You live by faith, but sometimes you just know that God is there. And after that, his life changed, I mean, dramatically. He became fearless. That night, the seed that would become Methodist was planted. Now, I don't usually spend a lot of time talking about Methodist or Nazarenes or anything else, because quite frankly, I'd be just real happy to be independent as a denomination. But I think this is as the fact that we probably are going global is probably the best thing to do as we discuss what's best for the church. So I don't get all caught up in the politics of churches. I just happen to be most of my life in one, but anyway. Now let's think about, just for a minute, about another great church leader, and that was Martin Luther, man of God, very similar in the way he was responding to the word, a professor at the university, smarter than all the rest of us perhaps, a priest, author, composer, monk, with all his brilliance and all his knowledge. Did he really know God or trust him? Well, he didn't think he did. He had no faith to do that. He struggled. He doubted. He worked hard for acceptance. He tried to do good things, do good deeds. He suffered depression over these same issues. He one time even flogged himself, trying to somehow be submissive. Still feeling condemned, not feeling worthy, then one day he read in the Bible a passage that he'd read over many, many times, I'm sure, and it was simply these words, but this time, it stuck. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. And we're not saved by his love, by the way, we're saved by grace, as we know. So, if we made it to heaven by our good deeds and our good works, we most likely would be subject to some of the most boring monologues describing how the good deeds open the pearly gates for each of us. I changed all the AC filters in the church every 2 months. I visited the nursing home. I sang on the worship team. I'm a stained glass artist. I took the pastor fishing. Yeah, you did that, Jim. And I helped Jim develop patience. You know how you develop patience? So the light comes on to Luther, and the Reformation follows, and therefore the five pillars of the Reformation. Grace alone, faith alone, Christ alone, glory to God alone, and then the Latin sola scriptura, meaning Scripture alone. That's the five. Grace alone, faith alone, Christ alone, glory to God alone, Scripture alone, none of this other stuff. Doesn't say anything about mowing the lawn at the church alone. Those are all things that follow coming to know Christ. But it doesn't help you one bit to step inside the pearly gates. So, those distinguish the reformers from the church at Rome, because the church at Rome included tradition alone, which is not even in the Bible. I mean, oh, well, we used to do this, so we're going to include this in Scripture. So here's where Luther and Wesley part company. These are things you probably don't even want to know, but I've got a few more minutes to. Luther says, if we're saved by grace through faith, then we are seen by God as being holy. But we're not. Luther says righteousness is imputed. In other words, it's assigned. It's credited. God looks at us, he says, through Jesus-colored glasses. Those are the words of Oswald. And he says, Bob is sinning, but I see him through Jesus, so I see him as holy. Wesley's not going to accept that. That's an interpretation. He said, thank God, I am saved by grace. Then he says something that resonates with me. All the words of the Bible that call me to share, and the Bible says I'm supposed to share his character, I'm supposed to be pure, and I'm share his love and his righteousness, in his holiness, then surely there must be some reason that the Scripture's there. Maybe I really can be holy. You know, God must really intend that I be righteous and holy because he said to. We're saved by faith, but we're also made holy by faith. So it's not imputed, it's not credited righteousness, it's imparted righteousness. God makes us truly righteous and holy and pure and clean, not by works, but by faith. So both Wesley and Luther say sanctification is by faith, but the Lutheran tradition says we're not really righteous, and the Wesleyan doctrine says we really are, and it is by faith. So you don't come to church so that I can stir you up to work harder around the church and enable you to earn salvation or sanctification, because what you will earn is the Lord may say thank you, and we will all say thank you, but it won't get you one step closer to being saved and sanctified. So the light comes on for Luther, and what happens when the light comes on? The Reformation. The light comes on for Wesley, the birth of Methodism all over the world. Okay, number three, sin is a matter of actions and disposition. A godly life avoids sinful acts and a sinful mind. The acts of sin have been dealt with, but sometimes we discover a three-year-old inside that says, but you know, I've been trying to be a good Christian, but I want my way this time, Lord. Don't tell me what to do. I've always done it this way. There's that something that's inside the little guy. So what have we done? We've come up against the disposition, the habit, the inclination, the nature. Deep within me, I've discovered a wall, a nature enthroned, self. It's a critical point. What am I going to do? Well, I guess this Christian life is too much. I don't think it's too demanding. I don't think I can love God the way I thought I could. I thought, you know, I was going to be great. Maybe I'm not religious material, or I just can't live that life. Now, here's the second moment of grace. God said, child, yeah, you, Bob, child, you don't have to live there. You're right. You cannot change your disposition, but I can. I can change it. And that's one of the examples of the crisis. I may do good works, but if my heart is not his, I have not been delivered from the power of sin. Wesley cried out for his heart to have a righteous disposition. God would deal with the acts of sin and the disposition. Let me just say this. I know I've lost some of you. I'm sorry, but God could deal with the acts of sin and the disposition and the inclination of sin all at the same time because he's God. All things are possible with God, but why doesn't he? When I come to Christ initially and I say, I'm sorry for my sins, forgive me, come into my life, we don't know the deep needs that we have, not really. When we inquire of God for salvation, our concern is about condemnation and guilt. We pray, oh God, forgive me, deliver me from sin, but we say, We say he forgives me and he delivers me. And then we begin this journey with Christ. And Oswald Chambers says, sanctification means being made one with Jesus so that the disposition that ruled him will rule us. Now, I'm going to try to pursue that a little more next week as I try to wrap this up and try to make it a little more understandable. Number four, sin is a matter, this is the one we really need to think about. Sin is a matter of imperfection and intention. It's true that sin is any deviation from God's perfection, okay? Wesley says, if I was to do something as simple as misjudge you, and I was wrong about you, it wouldn't have to be something bad or something good. If I misjudge you, I've sinned. Why? Because it's a deviation from God's perfection. God's perfection. So in that sense, since sin is a matter of imperfection and no one ever achieves sinlessness in that sense. Somebody once asked John Wesley, if you've been delivered from the disposition of sin, then why do you pray the Lord's Prayer? Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And this is what he said. In the sense that I fall short of God's perfection, I need his atoning blood every moment of every day. And Paul says it beautifully this way. I do forgetting those things which are behind and reaching. Let me begin again. This one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth into those things which are before, I press on toward the mark. That's an intention that's pure. So sin is a matter of imperfection, intention. So what does that mean practically? On the one hand, I cannot say I'm perfect. I know you thought I was, but I ain't. Just when I said ain't, that made me imperfect. On the other hand, I don't have to live with a guilty conscience saying I sin daily in thought, word, and deed. I never say that. I can't do anything about that kind of imperfection, but I can live with a clear conscience, knowing that he purifies my heart, and he knows my heart, and he knows the intention of my heart. He knows what's inside, and he knows when it is completely his and if it's completely holy. So sin is a matter of imperfection. That's any deviation from God's perfect will. But I want to say this. I don't feel a compulsion to close all my prayers with, forgive me for sinning in thought, word, and deed, because I don't think I do that. But even if I did, those are things that I'm not really responsible for. I don't even know if I do it. It's the kind of sin that I don't know. On the other hand, I might still occasionally say I may be praying for you or someone else, and I'll say, oh, by the way, Lord, if I failed you today in any way, I am so sorry, forgive me, and then go on. But here's where I'm responsible. This is a real important passage here. Wesley says, sin, rightly so called, is a transgression of the known law of God in a willful manner. You get that? Sin, rightly so, is a transgression of the known law of God in a willful manner. That's what I'm responsible for. Willful transgression. I did it. I knew it. I just may do it again. I mean, I like grace, so I'm going to depend on grace. Well, there's something about presuming upon God's grace, too. So, if you treat on an examination in your high school or college or at the license branch, that's a willful transgression. And if you commit adultery, that's a willful transgression. And if you stand up in court and you commit perjury, that's a willful transgression. And if you forget to include Bluebell ice cream at the next church luncheon, that sets a precedent, but it's not, well, I don't think it's a willful transgression. That depends on what you're thinking about when you don't get the ice cream. So, we serve God imperfectly, but the intention of our heart is what God sees, what he judges. I had the great privilege one cold Thanksgiving weekend in the Windy City to be present at Moody Bible Church. In fact, I remember getting up on that Thanksgiving weekend, the motel, and I said, you know, Marcia, there's got to be a Moody Bible Church because I know there's a university here. I'll bet there is one. So I checked, and sure enough, and I got to hear Dr. Warren Wiersbe. Dr. Wiersbe once spoke of hearing, maybe at that service, I don't remember, he's heard another minister say, most Christians are betweeners. Wiersbe wasn't sure about that. Of course, Wiersbe is a great scholar. I have some of his commentaries. But he asked the minister, what does that mean? Well, he said, most Christians are between Egypt and Canaan. They're out of danger, but they're not yet into the place of rest and rich inheritance. And then he went on and he said, they're between Good Friday and Easter Sunday. They're saved by the blood, but not yet enjoying newness of resurrection life. And that's kind of where a lot of us are, where we're followers of Christ, but we've never really got everything that God has for us. Or maybe we have. I hope you have. But even if we feel like that we have at some point had a crisis moment, we still continue to progress. Our sanctification is progressive all the way until we're glorified. So, the world is always present with us. You understand that when I talk about the world, the outside the Christian faith. The sinfulness of our hearts is strong enough that no one will ever make Jesus Lord without his help, without divine help. Your heart will wander, my heart will wander, every heart will follow the crowd if we don't have a divine, divine leadership. I don't want to live there. Entire sanctification, holiness, and perfection. Now, I'm going to try to finish that next week, and what you don't understand, you'll understand perfectly, maybe. And thank you for bearing with me. I mean, these are things that I think we need to talk about sometimes, but we don't very much. And so that kind of leaves us thinking, well, now, what does that mean exactly? If you're curious, you don't even have to go to the library anymore. You just get your phone out and pull it up. So I'm going to stop there, and I promise we'll try to iron it out next week. It's worth understanding. Let me introduce the benediction response, before I do that in the benediction, I just share this about the song, because she played it, and we're going to sing it again. We would have probably done that if it wasn't coming, but as we think about Thanksgiving. In 1978, a young seminarian graduate of the seminary, he's struggling. He's trying to find work. He's engaged to be married, and he's dealing with a degenerative eye situation where he's almost legally blind. And he responded one day to a sermon given by his pastor from 2 Corinthians 6:10. It says, sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, poor, yet making many rich, having nothing, and yet possessing everything. In response to his situation and to that scripture, he wrote a song that almost everyone has heard. Great lyrics to take, I think, to heart as we celebrate Thanksgiving. Get up Sunday morning, or Thanksgiving morning, and if there's several of you, just kind of go around the circle. And what are you thankful for? What are you thankful for? And the song, of course, is Give Thanks. We'll sing that in closing. Let's stand together for the benediction. We who are gathered here are the body of Christ in this world. Go in the immeasurably great power of Jesus Christ with thanksgiving. Amen.